Kimi Raikkonen could potentially, despite the shortened season, become the most experienced driver in Formula One history if he enters at least 12 races in 2020, which would see him surpass Rubens Barrichello, and on top of that, he could also be one of the few drivers in Formula One history to also race in three different decades. But putting Kimi's longevity aside for a second, how good was Kimi Raikkonen in his prime? Why is Kimi so loved and so treasured by the F1 community? And where exactly does he rank in the pantheon of Formula One greats? Hey guys, what's going on? My name is Aldas, and in today's video, I'm going to be talking about Kimi Raikkonen and how good he was in his prime. We're going to take a look at his career as a whole, and then just kind of talk about Kimi and why we love him so much, and really why he's almost become a little bit underrated in the Formula One community when you look at his career as a whole. Now guys, don't forget, if you do enjoy the content on my channel, don't forget to drop a like, smash that subscribe button as well, and check out my social medias, Instagram and Twitter will be above. But guys, let's get into this one. Before we delve into what made Kimi Raikkonen so special, I think it's very important to also talk about how he actually got into Formula One in the first place, because at the time he was actually quite a controversial driver. We expect the typical F1 rookie to be a well-polished and fairly experienced and successful racing driver in the lower categories before they even get into Formula One. Now in 2020, and actually over the past couple of years, it's almost become the norm. We've almost become accustomed to seeing drivers before they're even 20 years old. But even then, they're usually very talented, blisteringly quick, and also have a decent amount of experience to back them up. However, at the time of Kimi Raikkonen's debut, he came into Formula One as one of the most inexperienced drivers in F1 history. As an example, Max Verstappen, who is widely regarded as one of the most inexperienced drivers to ever make it into Formula One, he made his debut in 2015 at the age of 17, having competed in 47 either car or single-seater races before he got to Formula One. Lando Norris, a very recent example, of course, who made his debut last year in 2019 at the age of 19, he previously competed in 189 races before he got to Formula One. Kimi Raikkonen, on the other hand, when he made his debut at the age of 21, up until his first ever F1 Grand Prix, had only ever competed in 23 races prior to his debut. Which means, for comparison, although he was 4 years older than Verstappen, he technically had half the experience of actually racing professionally, which at the time was seen as very controversial, how someone with so little professional racing experience, and at such a young age as well, could be given a Formula One drive. However, as we know, talent talks the loudest, and after various tests with the Sauber team, Peter Sauber himself decided to give Raikkonen the drive for the 2001 season. Any doubters or any naysayers were immediately shut down, as Kimi finished 6th on his debut, scoring 1 point, and would finish the season in 10th place in the championship, having never finished any lower than 10th throughout the entire of his debut season. Kimi was destined for bigger things and wasn't going to spend much of his time fighting in a midfield car. His talent and potential to become a real superstar caught the attention of multiple top teams, including the likes of Ferrari and McLaren. Whilst the option to go to Ferrari did seem intriguing, especially in the early 2000s, considering how dominant they were then, it would have had to have been for the 2003 season, meaning he would have had to have been for Sauber for another year. Although, more importantly, Kimi Raikkonen would be a clear number two driver to Michael Schumacher, which to him, unsurprisingly, was not that attractive. McLaren, on the other hand, had just waved goodbye to two-time world champion Mika Hakkinen, and Ron Dennis wasted no time snapping up Kimi and replacing Finn for Finn to be partnered alongside David Coulthard. It turned out to be an inspired signing, and one that brought Kimi to the forefront of Formula One as he entered the prime of his F1 career. The McLaren move would be one of many big moves in Kimi's career that would see him race for some of F1's biggest teams. After starting at Sauber, he then moved to McLaren, where he stayed for 5 years. He then moved on to Ferrari before leaving the sport in 2009 to take part in rallying and NASCAR. Close cockpit racing didn't quite do it for Kimi, however, as he returned to F1 in 2012 with the Lotus team. Unbelievably, he then went back to Ferrari for 2014, doing something that is very rarely seen in Formula One, of a driver being able to go back to Ferrari, until he finally and ironically returned in 2019 to the team he started with, which was now rebranded as Alfa Romeo. Amazingly, that actually meant that, except for Sauber, every single team Kimi has ever raced for at one point in time and in various different forms had actually won a Formula One championship, which actually just shows the caliber of driver that Kimi Raikkonen has been throughout his entire career. When it comes to Kimi Raikkonen's prime, personally, I consider it between his early McLaren years and up until his second stint at Ferrari. But even saying that is almost a disservice to Kimi, because it's his longevity that is most astonishing, and the fact that ever since his first season and up until his most recent season, he's never really dropped off the level of a really quality driver that on his day can mix it up with the best in Formula One, regardless of what era of his career we are talking about. Kimi, from the moment he got to McLaren, looked absolutely fearless. He had a huge amount of raw talent, and it was more of a case of gaining more experience and just sanding out the rough edges until he would be ready to challenge and win a championship. What made Kimi stand out is that he literally and figuratively did his talking on the track. Although out of the car, he was a relatively quiet figure, of course, being nicknamed the Iceman due to his icy cool character. In the car, he was a racing animal, pushing his cars to their absolute limits, going wheel to wheel with no fear against absolutely everyone, because at heart he loved racing more than anything else, and it really did show in his performances. And of course, you can't underestimate the level of competition he was up against as well, which included the likes of Michael Schumacher, Fernando Alonso, and Juan Pablo Montoya, amongst others. All of this, his immense talent, and the fact that he was at McLaren, one of the greatest teams in Formula One history, should have delivered a title. But in F1, raw speed and talent is not enough, and undoubtedly one of the most frustrating things in the early days of Kimi's career was just how unlucky he was with reliability. Including his rookie year with Sauber and the 5 seasons he spent at McLaren, in 105 races, Kimi had 38 retirements, which is a retirement percentage of 36.2%. Now, while some of these were down to crashes, overall Kimi was a very clean driver on track, with really a fine balance between aggressive driving and respectful racing, which is why the majority of his retirements were down to reliability, and there is no doubt that he lost at least one championship whilst at McLaren due to poor reliability. Now, of course, this era of Formula One was dominated by the Schumacher-Ferrari combination, as they won 5 straight titles. But it's not as if McLaren never made a car capable of winning a title. Arguably, Kimi's best chance in the early days came in 2005, a season where F1's new generation of Kimi Raikkonen and Fernando Alonso battled it out for the title. On pure performance, the McLaren MP420 was the quicker car, up against the Renault R25, but Kimi was horribly plagued with poor reliability and some misfortunate incidents that cost him at key moments. Either way, the 2005 season saw Kimi produce some unbelievable performances, from taking pole position by half a second around the streets of Monte Carlo to producing one of the greatest comeback races of all time in Japan. After starting P17, he battled all race long, showing his quality, and eventually overtook Fisichella on the final lap to claim a truly sensational win. Absolutely no one could argue that Kimi was a championship quality driver, and his time at McLaren proved it. However, the frustration of being let down by McLaren time and time again meant that it was just time for a change, and that's exactly what happened as Kimi Raikkonen announced that he would move to Ferrari for the 2007 season. His first stint at Ferrari was the redemption he deserved, winning on his debut race for the Scuderia, and then going on to win his first world title at the first time of asking for Ferrari as well. You could not have found a more popular winner, and it was a title that was almost overdue for Kimi, but finally he had the world championship to match his incredible talent. And also, what a crazy season that was for Kimi as well. Although he won the first race of the season, he never led the championship after that for the whole season, until he won it in the season finale, beating a McLaren pairing of rookie Lewis Hamilton and two-time world champion Fernando Alonso. Although his first stint at Ferrari was relatively short, only lasting 3 seasons, and he couldn't quite also add another world title, he finally had a more reliable package at Ferrari. Although sometimes inconsistent, during his first 3 years at the famous red team up against Felipe Massa, he achieved 9 wins, 5 pole positions, 26 podiums, and that all-important world championship in 2007, which now solidified his status as one of the greats. After a mediocre 2009 season with a pretty poor Ferrari, the paddock was shocked actually when Kimi announced that he would be leaving Ferrari at the end of the season. Initially, he wanted to stay in F1, but only if he was in a top car. Red Bull at the time already had a solid driver lineup, Brawn was an uncertainty to say the least, and although he came close to partnering Lewis Hamilton at McLaren, negotiations broke down. Quite why he left Ferrari in the first place isn't 100% clear to this day. It's mostly down to the arrival arrival of Alonso, which Ferrari allegedly wanted to move up 1 year for him to start in 2010, which according to reports meant asking Kimi to leave before the end of his contract, for which Raikkonen received a reported £20 million for ending his contract a year early. So Raikkonen was out of Formula One. He dabbled in a bit of rallying and even NASCAR, but Formula One was his true home, and it was a home he no doubt wanted to return to. And so, to the delight of millions of fans around the world, Lotus announced that Kimi Raikkonen would make his comeback as part of their driver lineup for the 2012 season. His comeback was highly anticipated, and rightly so. Stepping into the Lotus for 2012, the Iceman picked up right where he left off, as if he had never left in the first place. He had lost none of his speed, none of his passion for racing, and also none of his charming Finnish charisma. His 2 years at Lotus were a success. It was the Kimi Raikkonen of old. He was exciting, he was quick, and he did his talking on the track. Although the team wasn't able to challenge for the title, they had a competitive car capable of getting podiums and the odd win there and there. Kimi managed 2 wins on his Lotus comeback, one at 2012 season in Abu Dhabi, and one in the first race of the 2013 season in Australia. And of course, not only was Kimi's talent back, but also his lovable personality. The next phase of Kimi's career was a surprise, to say the least. He returned to Ferrari for 2014. His second stint at Ferrari, however, wasn't as successful as the first, and this is where I consider the prime of Kimi's career to drift away a little bit. He was comfortably beaten by both Alonso and Vettel during their time as teammates, but once again, Kimi at no point ever looked out of place, and although he couldn't quite match the speed of Alonso and Vettel, he was a consistent point scorer and never had any ridiculous incidents, and just remained a quality driver, never looking out of sorts in a top team and never dropping below a truly quality driver. In terms of highlights during his second spell at the team, when Ferrari finally produced a competitive car, he achieved a pole position at Monaco in 2017, pole position again in Monza in 2018 at Ferrari's home race, and in one of the greatest moments in F1 over the last few years, and also after announcing he would leave Ferrari at the end of the year, he won the 2018 United States Grand Prix at Austin, to the delight of the entire Formula One world, as we saw the Iceman on the top step of the podium one last time. And of course, in classic Kimi style, he was absolutely overjoyed.
Well done, my friend.
Thank you. Finally, thank you, guys.
His love for racing didn't dwindle, however, as he returned to the team that he started his career with in Alfa Romeo, previously Sauber. And yet again, Kimi, despite being the oldest driver on the grid, he was the number one driver at Alfa in 2019, showing great speed and consistency at times in the midfield, mixing it up with drivers that were half his age. So, we also cannot talk about Kimi and his career without mentioning what a character he is. To me, he is the most honest and unapologetic driver on the grid, never pretending to be someone he's not, never being scared to say how it is, and also, of course, he is loved by the entire F1 community for his unintentional sense of humor that has just given F1 some of its most memorable moments. From his hilarious responses in interviews...
Kimi, what happened?
I spun.
Kimi, you missed the presentation by Pele.
Yeah.
Will you get over it?
Yeah, I was having a shit.
Okay, thanks for that.
To being drunk Kimi that definitely had the drink at the 2018 FIA prize-giving gala.
Kimi has enjoyed tonight a lot.
To even randomly eating ice cream during a crazy Malaysian Grand Prix that sent the F1 world into meltdown. And of course, who can't forget Kimi famously retiring at Monaco in 2006, after which he decided, instead of just heading back to the paddock, he just walked straight back to his yacht in the harbour and jumped into the hot tub midway through the race with some of his best mates.
There is Kimi Raikkonen. He's not even gone back to the paddock. He's got his shirt off. He's on his boat, which has a splendid name, One More Toy. He's with some of his best mates from Finland, who've consumed their own weight in champagne and beer while he's been off the pot all weekend.
Yeah, I could honestly write a book with all of the funny things that Kimi has done over the years, and that is why we love him. And what's amazing is, of course, to this day, at the grand old age of 40, he is still on the Formula One grid and still racing, still making legendary memes, with no sign of wanting to hang up his racing helmet just yet. That's the true Kimi Raikkonen, a pure, unfiltered racer that does it for the love of the sport, and I must say, I absolutely love it. So how good was Kimi in his prime? Well, he was a born racer, quick, exciting and absolutely fearless, which was seen from day one as he went up against some of the greatest drivers in F1 history and coming out on top. He is a deserved world champion and arguably deserved even more than that, and F1 will never forget the young kid at McLaren and the older guy at Ferrari racing against people from different generations and never looking out of place. Quite frankly, I wish he would continue racing in F1 for another 40 years. Because the day he retires will be a sad day for the sport, as Kimi Raikkonen will forever be one of the most beloved figures in Formula One. You just never knew what was going to happen next when he was on the screen. He was a true racer and an absolute legend in every sense. And don't worry guys, even though Kimi Raikkonen will retire one day and leave Formula One, he is already hard at work training up Raikkonen Jr. So yeah, thank you Kimi. Well guys, there you go. That was my video on Kimi Raikkonen, looking into how good he was in his prime. Now in the comments below, let me think of what you thought of the video and also what you think of Kimi Raikkonen and just how good he was in his absolute prime and where he ranks amongst the greatest drivers in Formula One. Now I hope you did enjoy this video, and if you did, don't forget to drop a like, smash that subscribe button. It really supports the channel. And also don't forget to check out my social medias. Instagram and Twitter will be above, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye guys.